Hello, welcome. I'm Dr. Suzanne Colson, and I welcome you on behalf of the Nurturing Project to the first of our free English-speaking webinars. The Nurturing Project is a small UK business whose sole purpose is to promote the biological nurturing approach to instinctual breastfeeding. And today, I'm proud to welcome the celebrated French doctor, Michel Audin, well known for introducing gentle and instinctual birthing practices across the world. Michel has graciously written the preface of my new book, L'allaitement instinctif, or Instinctual Breastfeeding, which published previously by Pinter and Martin, will be republished in French in March 2021. I've actually added 9 chapters, and I'm eternally grateful to Michel. Without him, I would never have become a midwife, but especially without Michel, I would never have been able to apply all his concepts and weave his rich fabric of understanding of mother's needs during birth within the breastfeeding context. Although Michel needs no introduction, I do wish to summarize parts of the life journey of this remarkable man. Michel was born in 1930 in a small village in Loise, a department just north of Paris near Beauvais. His mum was a poet, Madeleine Audin, and she always said that the best day of her life was the day she gave birth to him, importantly, at home. Michel studied medicine at the Faculté de Médecine in Paris in the 1950s and chose surgery as his specialty. This choice may have been a motivating factor in his profound understanding of women's needs during childbirth. In charge of the surgical and maternity units at the Pithiviers State Hospital in France from 1962 to 1985, Michel initially just performed cesarean sections when needed. However, learning from mothers who spontaneously released neocortical control during childbirth, and a small team of midwives who were mostly mothers themselves, Michel developed a special interest in environmental factors influencing the birth process. He introduced the concepts of home-like birthing rooms, birthing pools, and singing sessions for pregnant women. In fact, I often attended these sessions with Marie-Louise Auchère, a French soprano, with 2 of my 3 children every Tuesday evening. Following his hospital career, Michel became involved in home birth and founded in London the Primal Health Research Center. The extraordinary database that he designed compiles epidemiological studies exploring correlations between what happens during the primal period and health later on. Michel is visiting professor at Odessa National Medical University and honorary doctor of Brasilia University. Michel Audin has spent his life challenging the conventions of medical orthodoxy. A recent review of his new book, The Future of Homo, published by World Scientific, highlights that he goes well beyond the medical and explores the long-term effects of medical and societal interferences during the primal health period. And Primal Health was one of his first books published in English in 1984. Michel is a prolific author of 15 books published in 22 languages, including the first articles about the initiation of breastfeeding during the hour following birth, the first article about the use of birthing pools during labor, and the first article applying the gait control theory of pain to obstetrics. Throughout, he consistently refers to the concept of reduced neocortical activity as a key to rediscover the basic needs of laboring women and to prepare a real fetus ejection reflex. Michel's interpretations are astonishing and challenging. Today, he speaks to how the very act of giving birth prepares breastfeeding. Without further ado, I'm thrilled to present my lifelong friend, Dr. Michel Audin. So now I'm just going to put you, Michel, into the full space. And there you go.
Thank you, Suzanne.
My pleasure.
Yes. You told us what is our topic, what is the topic of the day. It's about the continuity between birth physiology and the physiology of lactation. How important it is to understand that when a woman is giving birth, she's preparing lactation. Why is it so important to introduce this topic today at this phase of our history? Is it to explain that today, at a global scale, at a planetary scale, most women have babies without giving birth. Today, most women don't need to release a hormonal flow or mixture of hormones to give birth to the baby and to the placenta. Today, most women replace this hormonal flow either with medication. Everybody heard about synthetic oxytocin, but epidural anesthesia, or cesarean section, but they don't give birth. Babies are delivered by health professionals. So it means that if there is a continuity between birth physiology and physiology of lactation, it's serious. It means that's a way to explain why so many women have difficulty to breastfeed. Why there are people like Susan Colson who are spending their time trying to help women to give birth. Women need help to give birth more than ever. So the point is that in some minutes, we don't need a long time, it's easy to explain that the birth process is a phase of preparation for lactation. It does not take long. It would have been difficult to talk about that 50 years ago. Today, it's easy. I'll give some examples among others. Today, if we consider, for example, the system of endorphins, everybody heard about endorphins, some kind of natural morphines women are supposed to release when giving birth. It's a way for them to protect against the effect of pain, is protecting, you know that. So what do we know today? We know today that beta endorphin, main endorphin, is a release of prolactin. That means that when a woman is giving birth by herself, when she's protecting herself by releasing this natural morphine, endorphin, she's preparing lactation. Beta endorphin is a releaser of prolactin, and everybody knows that prolactin is involved in the release of milk secretion. So it's very easy to explain such links. We can give another example in the system of oxytocin. Today, everybody heard about oxytocin. It's a term that nobody knew 50 years ago. Everybody heard about that today because people say oxytocin is the hormone of love. But an important point is how researchers in Sweden, Kerstin Uvnas Moberg in particular, have demonstrated that the way oxytocin is released when the baby is at the breast depends upon how the woman gave birth. Everybody knows today that the milk ejection reflex, and now we are not talking about secretion of milk, we are talking about ejection reflex, mechanical, is under the control of oxytocin, the hormone which is necessary to contract the uterus during labor. So the Swedish researchers looked at how oxytocin is released 4 days after the birth of the baby during a milk ejection reflex. So they have developed a system. We don't need details. The important point is to recall that to be effective, oxytocin must be released through pulsation. It's not continuous like prolactin. It's pump, 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 pulsations. And the oxytocin is effective when the release is very pulsatile. So this research team in Sweden has demonstrated that when a woman has given birth by herself with her own hormones, which is not common today, but it can happen without any medication, the release of oxytocin is very pulsatile. It's puff, 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 very pulsatile. It means very effective. So it's another way to explain in some minutes the strong links between birth physiology and the physiology of lactation. So when we understand that, when we realize what's happening today in the world, when we realize that today most women are delivered by health professionals and don't give birth by themselves, suddenly we say that we cannot study lactation breastfeeding without considering how it is prepared. What can we do? What can we do? We understand the current difficulties many women have when breastfeeding. We understand the reason, one of the factors. What can we do? If we can do something, it's trying to understand better the birth process. And it happens that today there are reasons for optimism. Suddenly, in a new scientific context, in a renewed scientific context, suddenly we have the possibility to rediscover the basic needs of laboring women after thousands of years of cultural interferences. The story started thousands of years ago with domination of nature, agriculture, animal husbandry, and socialization of childbirth, socialization of lactation, and so on. The story started like that. And since that time, we are always thinking as if women have not the power to give birth. So we are always talking about somebody delivering the baby. It was a cultural conditioning. The point, we have the limits of this cultural conditioning. Women don't give birth anymore. We have the limits. The point is that today, suddenly, in new scientific context, we can change our way of thinking. But for that, there are two conditions. The first condition to understand better the birth process, the first condition to understand what are the basic needs of a laboring woman. This is a question we have to raise. What are the basic needs of a laboring woman so that she can give birth by herself? Today, the first condition is to start from a new question. The point of departure, you know, way of thinking must be different. I must say, you mentioned my book, The Future of Homo. I must say that it's exactly the topic of this book. We have to phrase appropriate questions when we are in absolutely new situations. So the important point in this book that you have mentioned is the cover. What do you see on the cover? You just see a big question mark in red. The important point is to start from a good question, an appropriate question. And it's exactly what is wrong today. Today, you know that because you have been a midwife in the past, you studied midwifery, and you know that in your textbook, there were some pages about birth physiology. But you know that in these chapters, they were always starting from the same question. The question was, why giving birth is difficult among humans? Why is it difficult to give birth among humans? That's the point of departure. And immediately, they say it's difficult from mechanical reasons, morphological reasons. You show pictures of the size of the pelvis of the skeleton of the mother, pictures of the size and the shape, maybe the head, and say, for mechanical reasons, the birth process is difficult among humans, full stop. You don't need to say more, because you cannot change the shape of the body of the mother when she's pregnant. You don't need to say more, full stop, that's all. But suddenly, it becomes different if you choose another point of departure. Instead of wondering, why are human birth difficult? You wonder why, occasionally, even now in the 21st century, why occasionally it happens, some women give up easily, quickly. So simple, so why? So that's the right question. Why occasionally it's easy? Instead of, we forget this, it's so, because some women, most women have difficult birth today for obvious reasons. We forget to ask this question, why occasionally some women give birth easily? And that's a way to suggest new answers. If we take into account what we can learn today from emerging, fast-developing scientific disciplines, and in particular, neurophysiology. Today, if we start on this question, we realize that when we talk about birth physiology, we must realize that studying birth physiology is a chapter of brain physiology. Among humans, what's important is what's happening in the brain. Instead of always looking at the pelvis of the skeleton, of the perineum and so on, let's look at the brain, what happens in the brain when a woman is giving birth. And that's the key. If we take into account what we are understanding today, in particular from neurophysiologists, we say experts in brain functions. Suddenly, in this field, there is a real revolution. To understand this revolution, we must recall what everybody knows, that what makes human beings special, it's a huge brain. We have a huge brain. And in particular, we have developed to an extreme degree a part of the brain that we call the new brain, the neocortex, the new brain, which makes human beings special. It's because we have developed to an extreme degree this neocortex, this new brain, that we can develop sophisticated way to communicate. We can communicate now with Zoom, we can send human beings to the moon, we can do mathematics. Only human beings can do that. Why? Because they have developed this special part of the brain to an extreme degree. In this neocortex, human neocortex, has reached an extreme degree of development. So this is what we have to start from, that when we talk about what makes human beings special, what makes human beings special. The point is that until recently, it was commonplace to present this new brain, this neocortex, as a tool at the service of vital functions, providing information about time, space, facilitating communication. So it was a tool we had at our disposal. Today, we realize, thanks to modern neurophysiologists, we realize that it's not as simple as that. And we realize that in some situations, it's almost the opposite. The neocortex, the new brain, the logical brain, the brain thanks to which we can do mathematics and so on, in some situations can inhibit, can obscure, can make more difficult certain physiological functions. This is a concept of neocortical inhibition. It means that in some situation, some physical functions are more difficult, made difficult because of the activity of the thinking brain. And this is true for several kinds of physiological function. So the best way to explain the meaning of the term neocortical inhibition, the best way is to give an example. There are many examples. Because you are originally a midwife, you studied archaic, primitive reflexes, that you say reflexes that you can observe early in life among neonates, newborn babies, they have reflexes, but these reflexes will disappear for a certain degree of neocortical development. They will disappear. Activity of neocortex will inhibit them. That's a way to explain. But there are more simple ways. Let's take, for example, the case of the sense of smell. It's an important example because often we wonder why among humans the sense of smell is so weak compared to what it is among other mammals. There are many, many reasons, but one of them is the activity of the neocortex. And this has been demonstrated through very simple experiment. Mm-hmm. If you drink a glass of wine, wine means alcohol, reduce the neocortical control and your sense of smell is more powerful. Just that's a way to explain what is the concept of neocortical inhibition, which is becoming a key to understanding human nature in general and human birth in particular. We understand that what makes human birth difficult is activity of the thinking brain, of the neocortex. That's what we are learning today. And when we understand that, immediately, more easily, it does not take long, we understand, or some people can understand, the solution that nature found to make human birth possible in spite of this powerful neocortex. The solution that nature found to make human birth possible and even occasionally easy. It's a very simple solution. The neocortex must stop working. Giving birth is not the business of the thinking brain, of the logical brain, of the brain thanks to which we do mathematics. It's not the business of the neocortex. Giving birth is the business of archaic, primitive brain structures. So nature found this simple solution that can be understood even today by some people, solutions so that the birth process is possible. The neocortex must stop working. And in fact, I'm sure that among those who participate in our meetings, there are people who can understand that. There are still people who know what happens when a woman can give birth easily, quickly, does not need any drug, anything, and so on. In this case, this woman is as if cutting herself off from her world, forgetting what's happening around, forgetting what she read in books, for getting her plans. You know, now it's commonplace to make plans and so on and so on. She behaves in a strange way. Often she behaves in a way that usually would not be acceptable regarding a civilized woman. For example, she dares to scream, she dares to swear. Some symptoms that until now have not been noticed and interpreted. For example, a woman in hard labor can perceive odors that others cannot perceive. Her sense of smell is more powerful. And when a woman is like that in labor, spontaneous labor, she can find by herself, while she's as if another planet, she can find by herself bizarre postures, unexpected postures, primitive mammalian postures on hand and knees, asymmetrical, complex, and so on. What does it mean? It means there is no neocortical control, reduced neocortical control. When you associate all these signs, all these symptoms, it's obvious that there is a reduced neocortical control in general when a woman can give birth very easily and quickly. So this is a way to explain the solution that nature found to make human birth occasionally easy and at least possible. So when this point is understood, thanks to modern neurophysiologists, if we looked at what happened in the brain instead of looking what happened in the pelvis, you know, when this point is understood, suddenly it becoming possible to challenge thousands of years of cultural conditioning. Suddenly, we understand that because it's an involuntary process, we cannot help a woman to give birth. We have to change our way of thinking. Until now, we think as if a woman cannot give birth without some kind of cultural interferences. Women need other people to give birth, you know, helping, guiding, controlling, coaching, labor management, you know, all this supporting and so on and so on. But suddenly, when you think like modern neurophysiologists, we understand that we cannot help an involuntary process. The only thing we can do is to protect this involuntary process against inhibitory factor. And when we talk about birth among humans, the main inhibitory factors are well easily understood. It's neocortical activity, activity of the thinking brain. So when this point is understood, that to give birth a woman must stop thinking, a way to summarize, immediately we are on the way to challenge thousands of years of cultural conditioning. We are on the way to rediscover the basic need of a laboring woman. It's so easy to summarize. A laboring woman needs to feel protected against any kinds of neocortical stimulation. But it's simple. If you understand that, you guess the rest. It means laboring woman, it means, for example, that language inhibits the birth process. Language is a stimulant of the neocortex. It means that when a woman is giving birth, the worst thing to do is to talk to her. Language, stimulant of the neocortex. It means that she must be protected against the effect of light. Light is a stimulant of the neocortex. There is a lot to say about light today because we know that melatonin, the darkness hormone, work with oxytocin and so on. Today, what we have simply to say, the woman needs to be protected. The important point is to understand, to accept the word protection. instead of helping, protected against any stimulation of the neocortex. Language, light, and to summarize, to be fast, any situation that tends to stimulate the attention. Any attention-enhancing situation is a way to stimulate the neocortex. For example, feeling observed. If you feel observed, you observe yourself. It's a neocortical stimulation. Mm-hmm. Or perception of a possible danger. If you perceive a possible danger, you pay attention. So it's a way to summarize. We don't enter details, but it's a way to summarize that a woman in labor needs to be protected against anything that can stimulate her attention, so she can go to another planet more easily. And in particular, protection against the effect of language and light. So it means that today, the point is to change our completely our way of thinking. It's not easy after thousands of years of socialized birth. 10,000 of years of cultural conditioning. Cultural conditioning according to which a woman cannot give birth by herself. She needs some cultural interferences, helping, guiding, and so on and so on. So it's not easy. And it's not easy at a cultural level. It's not just a group of people who have difficulty to understand birth physiology. It's not special to medical institution. It's not special to people who promote what they call natural childbirth. It's cultural. The misunderstanding of birth physiology is cultural. I want to illustrate that by showing the cover of a book. It's significant because the author of this book, called Robert Bradley, is in America, and I'm sure because you are originally American, you know his name. Robert Bradley. Robert Bradley, during the second half of the 20th century, was a guru of natural childbirth. But he was sharing the cultural lack of understanding of birth physiology. And look at the cover of his book. What do you see on the cover? You see, quote, childbirth. What does it mean? It means you are unable to give birth. You need a coach. You need somebody to guide you, somebody who knows, somebody who has been educated. You cannot give birth. This by a guru of natural childbirth. It means that today, the misunderstanding, lack of understanding of birth physiology is cultural. It's everybody. Doctors, when they talk about labor management, people who promote natural childbirth and who talk about coach, it's a cultural. And we go a little farther, by the way. Who can be the best coach? Look at that. It's a man, the husband, can be the best coach, you know. And we can go still farther if we look at the top of the cover. You find the association of two words. It's a method of natural childbirth. Natural and method are incompatible words. A method is not, it's not never natural. So what I want to say, it's how difficult it is today to introduce these issues, because what we have to correct a deep-rooted cultural conditioning, new way of thinking, in particular among groups promoting what they call natural childbirth. So here we are at the present time. That's why it's so important for people who try to help women have difficulties to breastfeed, and it's very common, and we understand why. That's why it's so important to not to be too specialized, to think of how breastfeeding is prepared. In general, I must enlarge the topic that at a time when people are specialized, we are at the age of over-specialization, have a special interest in the continuity, the links, the continuity between physiological processes. We spoke about preparing lactation during the birth process. I'm interested in the physiological preparation to childbirth. Giving birth is prepared. And for example, and we don't pay attention to that. We don't talk about how childbirth is prepared, although we have the capacity, the possibility to do it. For example, we know now with studies with MRI, brain imaging, that before giving birth, when a woman is preparing herself to give birth, when she's not yet in labor, some parts, some zones of her gray matter of her brain are shrinking. And these are part of the brain involved in socialization, preparing. She's preparing herself to desocialize, to give birth. We also know that the days before the birth, the hormone, the concentration in the hormone melatonin is increasing. So that's another example of how important it is today to study the continuity between physiological processes. And there is to understand that there is also a phase of physiological preparation to childbirth. Important also to understand that, because it's a phase that often we eliminate by inducing labor or by pre-labor C-section. Many ways to eliminate or to shorten the phase of preparation to childbirth. So enlarge the topic to emphasize how important it is today not to be too specialized, to focus more on period of transition, to understand that one physiological event is preparing the next one. So I found it useful to enlarge the topic a little bit to realize the dangers of specialization. And in particular, now a good example is how useful it would be today to rediscover the basic need of laboring women. It's very difficult because it changes our way of thinking. It's incredible. It's not like assimilating a new technique. It's changing our way of thinking. And how difficult, for example, to eliminate words like helping, guiding, and to think of protecting. It's difficult, but it's part utopian, but utopian does not mean impossible. Thank you.
Oh, lovely. Thank you. Let me see if I can get the full stage back here. There we go. Thank you so much, Michelle. Wow. It's been 40 years that I've been listening, over 40 years that I've been listening to you. And every single time I learn something new. So this has just been a brilliant talk. And thank you so much for sharing with us new ways of formulating questions. And certainly I'm going to take that and run with it towards breastfeeding, because mothers are coached concerning breastfeeding, and maybe we just need to protect an environment conducive to high oxytocin pulsatility. So thank you very, very much for sharing this with us.
I was pleased to meet you again.
Lovely to see you. And
we keep in touch.
Let's keep in touch. And bye-bye. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.